My name is Clark Ashton, and I make metal things. Well, I started welding back in 1976 or something like that, and did it for a couple of years. But I always liked welding, I just didn't want to do it for a living. And my creative outlet was as a musician. But then I got frustrated with the creative compromises involved in group projects and so forth.
And decided just to go out and buy a welding machine and start making metal men was the idea that I had. I wanted to construct this scene of these metal men all over the front yard doing some kind of battle or something. And,
grew from that, the metal men. Moved out of figurative stuff into architectural stuff, and then started merging the figures with the architectural work and getting a kick out of making these dog heads and cat heads and bird things and just going, this is kind of cool, I'll make these things. And then when I put them all together, I realized what it was all about. These are all unemployed souls that have been cast out of society. We have the insane and the infirm. We have the elderly and we have the homeless. And these are all devils to a society that worships boundless productivity and growth. It's hopeful angels that are hoping for a state of social equality that will raise these outcasts up from their status as victims of human objectification as a result of the capitalist wheels that are turning along self-driven by their own momentum. And so what you have here is a passageway to a socially acceptable existence in the mainstream of gainfully employed individuals. The final sirens of warning as you enter into the employed realm of the screaming angels, and they tell of the imminent disconnection of the self that occurs when you subject yourself to the commodified labor realm. At the pinnacle of the social hierarchy, at the top of the holy arch here, are the vultures, and they're feeding on the carrion of all those that are unable to function within their system. And they place the heads on the pickets as a warning to anybody who might try to exist outside of that system. But the system's not perfect, and a downturn and economic conditions can result in the stagnation of the wheels of industry. And so here you have the wheels of industry have become static and unemployment is rising and there's more individuals out there in the population that aren't able to find work. And when that occurs, the risk of anarchy sets in. And so the vultures have to call on things like traditional values to try and calm the masses so that they don't get overthrown. And in this particular situation, we have seven unemployed Jesuses coming out to pray for the wheels of industry to start turning again. They're kind of like politicians that would preach economic salvation under their policies. The prison of gainful employment right here, within which I was trapped for many years, but then I was rendered unemployed. At that time, I had an opportunity to think about what I was supposed to do with myself and my life. So I started making art.
So this is the piece that's called Boundary. Looks like a cup.
Well, I say that it depicts time and separates space.
And at the bottom registers the past, and we have these sperm skeletons that represent the physical past, all life that's gone before, from the very first spark in the primordial seed to the last microprotoplasm that just inspired nitrogen. And then you have the eel men, which is the spiritual past, because all cultures create these belief systems so that people have somewhere to go. And in the middle register is the present, and all these people dancing about in mating rituals, running this way and that way, chasing each other down, going somewhere to exchange their surplus value. And at the top is the vultures, the future, the imminent demise of all lives and people and places and things and cultures.
And then there's an opening in the boundary from which I can communicate from my peaceful home space to the chaotic world of life in transit.
So I could sit here in the morning and drink my coffee and read the newspaper, and while everybody was leaving home, going somewhere else, I would recreate community in this transient environment. You can't have community when everybody's leaving home. That's why communities fall apart, because nobody stays at home. And so people, a lot of people would worry about it. They'd see me out here, and I'd be looking at them, and they'd be driving by, and they'd be looking at everything, and then they'd see me sitting there, and they wouldn't look and stuff. So I wound up making this sign that said there's no cause for alarm and setting it out there in the front yard for a long time.
I was always interested in, you know, where do people get their ideas about God and so forth. if you look at it from an anthropological, theoretical standpoint, it's about psychic unity and various people trying to achieve a state of psychic unity. We can't really figure out where we came from, why we're here, or where we're going in terms of, or through the scientific process. So we create these belief systems. And so I built these objects of industrial aesthetic to sort of present those ideas and interact with them.
Then I wound up calling it Faith in Industry. And what it's about is a complex to manufacture psychic unity using commuters as raw materials. And we have that right here in the Mechanical River, where psyches are running up and down the road every day. There's a full supply of psyches with which to manufacture psychic unity. The first thing we need is the sky saw to cut a hole in the sky and thereby create the psychic opening. And once the psychic opening has been prepared, the hole in the sky is ready, that's when I ascend into the control tower, which has an arm that reaches out, breaking the plane of chaos that's set up by the boundary. And I harvest souls from chaos as they're lost in the mundane ritual of the daily commute. The weight of their soul is checked by the Plumb Bob judgment scale on the back of the control tower, and the soul is directed either to the hole in the sky where psychic unity will occur, or to the hole in the ground where they'll have to study yin-yang and mop floors until they're ready for personal spiritualism at some future time. Then, the third tool in the ritual is the sky stitcher, in which we sew the hole in the sky back up again.
Trying to get a connection with the other side of consciousness, we get it through the sky saw, through that psychic opening. And if we're trying to get rid of one that's causing some problems, then we'll close it up with the sky stitcher. Or if you just need some sort of secular sense of power and control, then you can get up in the control tower and pretend that you're an executive on the top floor, or God in heaven, or whatever you need to be. And so it's not really supposed to be a preachy kind of thing at all. It's more like just me doing my thing. I'm just staying at home and reflecting on what it is that I see and doing things that are satisfying to me rather than engaging in the system and doing less satisfying things for money.
And so after that, it was sort of like, well, what am I going to do now? I'd manufactured psychic unity, and it's like, well, once you've done that, it's kind of, what do you do? And so I thought, well, I guess I'll just have to predict the future.
I started just paying more attention to contemporary society, and
everything's being supersized. You go to Burger King and they're going to supersize your fries for you. You turn on the television, you're going to watch the superstation. You go down the road, you're going to drive on the superhighway. You can't just go to Walmart anymore, you have to go to Super Walmart. I had a sky saw already, so I thought, well, I must need a super saw. I had a control tower, so I must need some kind of super control tower.
And so I decided to build a super structure that would sort of be an artifact of the supersizing.
This is the sewer brick road that leads up to the superstructure. And you have all these people out here working and slugging it out in society, riding up and down the road every day to earn their, you know, dollars so they can put tires on their car and gas in their car so they can keep going up and down the road every day so they can get 2 weeks vacation and go to Cancun. They're out here slugging it out, walking down the sewer brick road, and eventually they decide, man, I'm just getting hosed down out here. That damn super hoser's hosing me off everywhere I go. I want to get inside the superstructure. I want to be in control. So you go to Harvard Business School, and you get yourself a degree in business. Then you find yourself inside the superstructure. You're doing the hosing now. You get to operate the super saw.
cutting super-sized holes in the sky. But sometimes things break, and you don't want to be caught into a situation where something's breaking down on you when you're needing a good hole in the sky. And everybody needs insurance, so that's why we got the secondary saw over here. You're doing your super hosing. You got your super hoser hosing everybody down out there. But you got to send out the word. It's like, what am I going to do? What do we need to keep this structure going? We got the super dogmatizer. This is how we get the information out to the masses. It's through the super dogmatizer. So the masses are out there saying, what should I do? All the employees are at the Enron meeting. And they ask, well, we've got lots of Enron stock in our 401k plans. Should we buy more? And the public relations people look at each other and they go, oh yes, absolutely. So they effectively steal millions and millions of dollars from regular hardworking people's retirement and ruin their lives and ruin their savings and ruin their retirement. And then the next thing you know, it's like, oh, somebody's getting caught. Then what? It's like, oh, well, perhaps we're done with you now. We don't need you anymore. Good job there, fella. Head on out here to the final exit gate. And so after you've worked cutting supersized holes in the sky and selling people insurance and sending out the dogma out to the masses, all designed to screw everybody out of everything, then you find yourself faced with the super hoisters. And you realize, I'm just a mortal person, and it's pretty much all over for me now. I'm about to lose my job, and I'm heading out the final exit gate, and in fact, I might even lose my life eventually. And you have to ask yourself, was it all worth it? Did you really need to screw all these people? You got the super shaft over here violating the super-sized hole in the sky. And then you moved on along into the chump chute here. When they're done with you, they put you into the chump chute. But you don't realize this, of course, till you get in here a little bit, and then they cram somebody in behind you. And when you get here, you realize there's no steps leading out of here. It's just a bunch of gas burners all the way around the thing. So you're shuttled in the chump chute. You go, oh no, oh no! And then that's the end of you.
100,000 years from now, when modern industrial society has ruined the planet, when it's exhausted all the resources, when it's polluted everything, when we've killed each other over that which we cannot understand, and there's really nothing left anymore except the ruins. And this is sort of like a Rosetta Stone.
Whoever gets here after humanity is gone, and they say, well, what happened here? Obviously, they built this enormous system and society, and why did it all go away? And so the infrastructure of an uncertain future is sort of a key, a Rosetta Stone, if they can possibly figure it out. You know, the answer is there as to why we destroyed ourselves. Sort of one last ditch effort to wake people up to the fact that they're wrecking the place and that this is all that's going to be left. And if I can get enough of these signals out there, maybe I can save the world. Somebody's got to do it.